वेलकम टू द चैनल फ्रेंड्स। आज काफ़ी दिन बाद मैं फिर से एक ट्रैवल रिलेटेड वीडियो लेके आया हूँ। जैसा कि आप सब लोग जानते हैं कि कोरोना COVID-19 पैंडेमिक की वजह से अक्रॉस द ग्लोब मूवमेंट रिस्ट्रिक्टेड है, लॉकडाउन चल रहा है, लोग घरों में हैं, दफ्तर भी बहुत कम लोग ही जा रहे हैं। यहाँ पर भी मेरा मूवमेंट अभी रिस्ट्रिक्टेड है। हम लोग ज़्यादा क्या बिल्कुल भी ट्रैवल नहीं कर रहे हैं अभी, और समय की यही मांग है कि हम घर में रहें और सुरक्षित रहें और इस बीमारी को फैलने से बचाएं। पर फिर भी मेरे पास कुछ कुछ कहानियाँ, कुछ वीडियो फुटेज रिकॉर्डेड पड़ा था जिसको मैं अभी तक एडिट करके शेयर नहीं कर पाया था। तो अभी मैं सोच रहा हूँ कि इन दिनों कुछ उस पिटारे में से वीडियोस निकाल करके मैं शेयर करूँ वो कहानियाँ। जनवरी से लेकर अभी तक का जो सफ़र रहा है वो काफ़ी थोड़ा हेक्टिक रहा है मेरे लिए। जनवरी में मैंने, जैसा कि एक पहले वीडियो में शेयर भी किया था, कि ऑफिस के काम की वजह से मुझे US ट्रैवल करना था। वर्मोंट हम लोग गए थे वाया दुबई। एक एपिसोड में हमने उस जर्नी के बारे में भी शेयर किया है, वाया दुबई जो वर्मोंट की जर्नी थी। और पर उसके बाद से, वहाँ से लौटने के बाद से ऑफिस में काफ़ी ज़्यादा काम रहा, तो मैं वीडियोस को कंप्लीट नहीं कर पाया उस समय। और उसके बाद से ये एपिडेमिक शुरू है, जिस वजह से थोड़ा तो एक स्पीड ब्रेकर आया हमारे लाइफ में। पर उसके बाद हमने, लकीली मैं IT इंडस्ट्री में भी काम कर रहा हूँ, तो जो दफ्तर का काम घर से करने की सहूलियत है हमें, वर्क फ्रॉम होम जिसे बोलते हैं, लेकिन शुरुआती दिनों में थोड़ा सा लैग आया, हमें आदत नहीं थी उस मोड में रेगुलर काम करने की, तो थोड़ा सा काम भी स्लो रहा 1-1.5 हफ्ते करीब। पर हमने फिर कैचअप कर लिया और फाइनली अब जा करके मुझे थोड़ा सा समय मिला, तो मैंने उस वीडियो फुटेज को फिर से देखा और अब मैं शुरू कर रहा हूँ वो जो US की जो जर्नी थी, उसके कुछ एपिसोड्स मैं आप तक ले करके आऊँगा। तो आज के एपिसोड में हम चलेंगे वर्मोंट इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ नेचुरल साइंस। ये जो जगह है, एक तरह से यहाँ पर जो वहाँ की नेचुरल हिस्ट्री है और जो जीव हैं, तरह तरह के पक्षी, सांप, टर्टल्स, कछुए, उनके बारे में, यहाँ पे उनका रिहैबिलिटेशन भी होता है, जो ज़ख्मी जानवर होते हैं उनका रख रखाव किया जाता है, देखभाल की जाती है, और एजुकेशनल पर्पसेस से, एकेडमिक पर्पसेस से जो लोग आते हैं, जो सीखना चाहते हैं नेचुरल साइंस के बारे में, उनके लिए एक तरह से ये एक एक्टिव म्यूज़ियम है। यहाँ पे कर्मचारी काफ़ी हेल्पफुल हैं, काफ़ी जानकारी देते हैं जानवरों के बारे में, उनके नेचुरल हैबिटेट के बारे में। और आप इस एपिसोड में देखेंगे कि हम टर्टल्स के बारे में और सांप के बारे में और कुछ बड़े ही नायाब पक्षी जो यहाँ के होते हैं उनके बारे में आप जानेंगे। और साथ में, जैसा मैंने पहले भी कहा था कि मेरे लिए काफ़ी नया एक्सपीरियंस था कि इतनी ठंड और इतनी बर्फ़ चारों ओर, तो जनवरी जो मंथ है जिसमें मैं उस जगह गया था, वो वहाँ का पीक विंटर्स का समय है और काफ़ी ठंड थी वहाँ पर फिर भी मेरे कलीग और दोस्त डेनिस ने मुझे वो शहर दिखाया वीकेंड पर। ही वॉज़ काइंड इनफ कि उन्होंने समय निकाला और मुझे वहाँ की बहुत ही पेक्यूलियर चीज़ें दिखाईं। वो जानते थे कि मैं ज़्यादातर मॉल्स और ये सब में इंटरेस्टेड नहीं रहता हूँ, हेरिटेज साइट्स या नेचुरल हिस्ट्री जहाँ पर हो, नेचुरल साइट्स, बायोडाइवर्सिटी पार्क्स या फिर नदी का किनारा, इस तरह की चीज़ों में ज़्यादा इंटरेस्टेड रहता हूँ। पर हाँ, क्योंकि वहाँ हर जगह बर्फ़ जमी थी, तो हम ज़्यादा हाइकिंग, ट्रैकिंग ये सब तो नहीं कर पाए, लेकिन हाँ, वो मुझे एक फार्म में लेकर के गए और एक आज वाले एपिसोड में जो हम देखेंगे नेचुरल साइंस इंस्टीट्यूट, वहाँ पर हम लोग गए और काफ़ी हमने उस दिन नायाब चीज़ें देखी, जो मैं काफ़ी खुश लौटा और मैंने काफ़ी आभार व्यक्त भी किया डेनिस को। और ज़्यादा समय ना लगाते हुए, लेट्स स्टार्ट दिस एपिसोड और मुझे आशा है कि आपको पसंद आएगा। ये एक भारत से बाहर की एक जर्नी, एक नया देश है, नया कल्चर, और मेरे लिए तो ये सब नया था, तो मैं काफ़ी एक्साइटेड हूँ कि ये नया अनुभव आप तक लेके आ रहा हूँ। आशा है फिर से स्थिति सुधरेगी और हम ट्रैवल भी कर पाएंगे और हम आप तक नई नई जगहों को यूट्यूब के माध्यम से लेकर के आते रहेंगे. गॉड ब्लेस यू ऑल, हैप्पी एक्सप्लोरिंग.
My dirty windows aren't. Yeah, this is probably a pretty crazy winter wonderland.
Yeah, it's my first time at such temperatures.
Yeah, it got cold yesterday. I was like, oh man, I hope the teacher's all right. Because
it's gonna do. Okay.
Oh. Let's see. This is.
What do you call him? What gorge?
This is called Queechy Gorge.
And that's Dennis for you. He's showing me the place around. Queechy Gorge.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. Queechy is the town here. That's pretty much it.
That's amazing. Like. This town is called Queechy, or?
Yes.
Okay. It's not actually like that cold. You have snow around, but it's not. It's warm.
Yeah.
The sound of this is really amazing. It must be sounding good when you don't have vehicles around.
Yeah. And there's trails to go down there and stuff, but I don't think I'm gonna try them right now.
Definitely not. It's almost vertical. This is like, what's the source of this water? It's coming from the hilltops?
Or? Yeah, it just comes from the hills around here.
And this goes on like year round?
Oh yeah. This is, it never dries out or anything.
This much volume itself, or it goes broad?
When we get like a hurricane or a really big storm, the water level will come way up.
Oh.
But that's pretty rare.
Thank you. That's an amazing start to the day. Really. Is there a full form to VINS, or that's the name? Like?
It's Vermont Institute of Natural Science. I think everyone around here has called it the place with the birds. Young, they have just a brown head, but the adults have a head.
That's like the way they're built, like all the animals. I really admire like the UI that nature created.
Yep. If it doesn't
perfect.
Work, then they don't survive. So this whole area is full of
birds of prey.
Birds of prey.
Okay. Kids must be like enjoying this a lot. They have a similar place in Brisbane for koalas.
Oh yeah.
It's amazing. Like, they don't have these cages. You just at a distance. You got this questionnaire and the answers.
Really nice for academic purposes.
This wood turtle is over, I think she's over 45 years old now. She was rescued in Pennsylvania as a very small turtle. She was run over by a car. Certainly could have been released back into the wild once her shell healed, but they decided to keep her as an ambassador for the species. And she was transferred up to Vins in the mid-80s. So she's very comfortable around people. probably wondering, why didn't you bring me worms today? Because I have a compost pile at home, so sometimes I'll get a treat for. But look at that beautiful burnt orange skin, just typical of their species. And then she's got this beautiful lower shell, the plastron.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell female because the plastron is flat. And a male's is going to be slightly concave, so he can rest on top of the female's shell. And she also has very strong legs, so I need to make sure that I have a good grip
claws,
on her. And so the shell, which also consider basically scales, is layers of keratin that for wood turtles, as they grow, the new keratin comes in and pushes up the old keratin and gives them a sculpted appearance, like tree rings. Some species, I know the painted turtle will actually shed some of their old scutes, but not the wood turtle. But she's got nerve endings here. She's got a spine and ribs, like this model will show. And the side of the lower and upper shell are connected by what they call a bridge. But you know, some people think, oh, it's a hard shell, you can just knock on it. They got a lot of nerves in their shell. So knocking on their shell is not appreciated, or poking them in the head. I'm gonna put her back so I have time to bring out the snake. So they do get offered a balanced meal every day, protein, fruit, and vegetables. And if I can put some worms in my compost pile, she basically will just almost run up. I mean, if a turtle can run, she can come right up to me and eat the earthworms. Backbone that a snake has. A little more flexible than ours. And a few more ribs. What do you think?
Yeah. Wow.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi there. I'm just getting ready to take out the snake. I just brought out for education purposes. This is not a snake native to this area, to New England. It's the range is actually here. So they're found like from New Jersey south down to Florida, over to Louisiana. So if you happen to see one in the wild around here, someone has done a no-no and released a non-native species. And who knows, with our climate change, maybe they could survive. But. All right, so if anybody wants to see a two-headed snake, they like to be right on top of each other. So I've got two heads. So the male is larger. He's on the bottom and he's a little bit darker, so I can tell who's who. And it's the female who gets to come out. But sometimes they're so entwined that it really does look like a two-headed snake.
Mm-hmm.
So for anyone who would like to, you're welcome to touch the snake. I'd ask that you wash your hands next door in the restroom. But they're not slimy. They're smooth. So who would like to touch?
I would.
We're both like, yeah.
And they're not, and she's nice and warm.
She's nice.
Yeah.
Oh, you're getting all tangled up in yourself, honey.
Well, they're constrictors.
So
and also feel, I just need to make sure she feels secure so she doesn't constrict. Feel the belly scales. They're very, very different.
Oh, wow.
Ooh. Soft lady.
Yeah.
That's how she's got to be smooth.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yay. Good.
She's sniffing.
So, corn snakes, I guess since the mid-1600s, they've been called corn snakes, and it could be because the belly. You know, you wouldn't see that in the wild necessarily. Might remind people of Indian corn. But it's more, I think, that because their primary prey are rats and mice, they were also commonly found in farmers' corn cribs. So that was a great place for hunting. And then, so they, like, it can be found in abandoned buildings, barns, overgrown fields, some deciduous trees. They'll do partial arboreal hunting as well. And then they've adapted to suburbia because people's basements are nice and warm.
Mice and small rats. And then the tongue, its fork, it's probably all, and that's how snakes are smelling. They do have the eyes, their eyesight isn't the greatest, it's because they're hunting primarily in dark conditions or darker conditions, but, and their nostrils are for breathing, but they smell through their forked tongue. It collects molecules and transfers it to a special organ inside their head that transfers the information to the brain. Mm-hmm. And the forked tongue enables them to determine what direction their prey is in. Isn't that cool? It probably helps with heat sensing too, is my guess.
No,
I just think she's adorable. Hi!
Yeah, I can't let her crawl on you, but I mean partially, but that's okay. And then snakes don't have any eyelids. So they're always going to look awake. They do sleep, but you have to get close enough to see if the iris is closed. But
lighter color in the males, closer to 5 feet, and a darker color. Feeding them once a week, and then it was noticed they're to prepare food. We don't feed live prey, neither here nor. Our raptors have all adapted to prepared food because we don't want.
Do you want to put them?
We don't want to risk.
Do is they help
to essentially mitigate the glare from the sun. So these birds are insectivores. They'll sometimes even hunt for a little songbird if they can, but for the most part, they're grabbing things out of the air. And what that does is that means that they're sometimes facing directly at the sun. And they don't have a baseball cap, they don't have sunglasses, but someone that we do recognize having malar stripes kind of are football players. Football players have the black on their cheeks. It's for the same reason, to help with the sunlight. Now, kestrels use these malar stripes in two different ways. He is a smaller bird. Other birds or other larger predators might want to hunt him. Aurora was not a patient with us. In fact, he has no injuries whatsoever. He was actually born in captivity. And the reason he was born in captivity is because these birds had a really severe drop in their populations all over the country. Now we think that this drop in population coincided with the popularization of rat poison. So the things that these birds mainly eat are mice, small rodents, and unfortunately, when these birds come in contact with a mouse that's been poisoned, it can only take one or two mice to kill a bird this size. Even though he looks a little bit big, he only weighs a pound or two at most. They're very lightweight birds. These guys are cavity nesters, but they prefer to nest in a little bit larger area. It has been used in what is called the sport of falconry. So that is actually the sport of hunting with a bird of prey. And how he came to be with us is there was a falconer who actually purchased him and donated him to us so that we could have a fully flighted bird with no injuries. But that being said, we wouldn't ever find one of these birds around here. We would never have one of these birds coming into our rehab. So he's very unique to this area. Where this bird actually resides is the Sonoran Desert, and even further south into South America. But they've got some really interesting traits that help them out to survive in this desert. And the first of which you might notice just from looking at him, he's wearing short shorts. And that's really hot in the desert. So he doesn't want to have feathered legs, because he would just simply overheat. Now, parrot hawks that live in the Sonoran Desert have been known to do something really, really unique that no other hawks have ever been documented doing. They actually hunt in packs. So what this means is that they will be able to get prey that is much larger and more difficult to get than they would be able to get on their own. Now this is because they are in the desert. Their meals are pretty few and far in between. It's pretty tough for them to be able to find a meal every single day. So it's more convenient and actually really beneficial if they can have a larger meal that they can share between them. Now what these guys are looking for are things like rabbits. In particular, there is a rabbit called the jackrabbit, which is a really, really large rabbit that is actually over 10, sometimes up to 10 pounds. Now this guy, he weighs about 2 pounds on a good day, maybe 2.5 pounds. They will actually gang up, and which is when they actually sit on each other's shoulders, looking out to the horizon, seeing if they notice any movement, anything like that. And what they're looking for is some fur, some movement. And once they see that, once they've made eye contact with the jackrabbit, they will actually begin chasing it, getting a larger food, source, so a larger food item that they can share amongst themselves. They're also doing a much better job statistically of hunting. They're exerting less energy for how much food they're getting. So it's really important for these birds, when they're out there in the wild, to have strategy, to have strategies to,
So do you usually have like water going beneath this, or is it just for fun?
I think it's to try to get people up to the, you know, like tops of the trees.
Oh, okay.
Kind of get a little different perspective than the normal ground hikes. That, you know, just everywhere. And it makes you realize that there was just farms everywhere, and now we think of it as a very forested place, but it wasn't, you know, 150 years ago.
So this bridge and this structure is like the forest canopy walk, or we can get down and go to these places? You're not going to do that right now, but I'm just asking.
So, yeah, this is a forest canopy walk.
Okay.
And there's trails that go under here, but we actually might have a hard time.
Yeah. That's the sound I'm asking about. Is that the road, or you hear this? Sounding like
I think it's a little of both. And this is the river that goes into the gorge.
That's, which river is this? So when we call it White River Junction, like which river is that?
So there's the White River, which is not this one.
Okay, the name is White River.
The White River, at White River Junction, the White River comes in and to the Connecticut.
Okay.
And this is something else. This is the...
White River is different than White Waters, right? Typically,
yes.
Okay.
Yeah, but named for the same, named because it goes over so many rocks that it looks
That's
white.
That's why it's called White River?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's Dennis, who's been kind enough to come out to this height in this cold weather just to show me the place around.
No problem.
I really appreciate and bless him. And you might see him in Delhi soon with me.
Yeah. Hopefully.
It's all snow and white here. Probably, I guess that's why when Americans visit India, they're all about colors and so amazed with the colors. Like, we usually don't even notice that something is so colorful.
Color, when all the leaves on the trees turn red, yellow, orange, right before they fall off in September.